I can usually handle a lot of meat, but that was really dirty. I'm not gonna say that. I'm gonna stop. This is a family-friendly program.
Hi, I'm Frank. I'm a professional chef, and this is a $250 Bolognese.
Hi, I'm John. I'm a home chef, and this is gonna be a $25 Bolognese.
Again.
Oh my God.
Stroke the celery.
Okay, I just got really nervous. This is like something from the Flintstones. I have Frank's recipe book here.
The bolognese I planned on making, you've probably seen a more expensive Italian restaurant. It's better ingredients, higher quality, and because of the high quality, you're gonna pay a little more. It's gonna be expensive.
This is a lot of ingredients to make a bolognese.
For my bolognese, I was planning on using short ribs.
This is meat. What the hell do you do with this?
I was gonna use guanciale.
Guanciale? Oh, it's not pancetta.
Red wine, good olive oil.
This looks like just some really fancy olive oil and wine. If I'm allowed to, I definitely wanna take this bad boy home.
Lots of basil, a little bit of orange rind.
I don't know why we have an orange. I don't think it belongs in ragu sauce.
Calabrian chilies.
I could hear that there's the little seeds in there. I'm guessing that's what I'm working with.
These are the things that I believe make the foundation of a good meat sauce or a bolognese. For my fresh made pasta, I was gonna use duck eggs.
Oh lordy.
Duck eggs are gonna be a little bit richer than chicken eggs.
Very surprised about the pasta. Making homemade pasta for the first time, gonna make grandma proud.
I was gonna use 00 Italian flour.
00, like James Bond. Turns out this is laminated pasta. I don't know what that means.
And I had everything together to make a fresh dough for some homemade garlic knots.
Like what? That's insane. By my count, I'm making not one, but two doughs, we shall overcome.
So for John's recipe, we have simpler ingredients. Ground beef and ground pork. Some pecorino romano, some butter, tomato paste. Instead of guanciale, we're gonna use bacon. Dried pasta, parsley, garlic, carrots, onions, and some white wine. John's ingredients might be simpler than mine, but I think with good technique, we can elevate them and make them better. If I had a guess, this would probably cost about 25 bucks. On the money, huh? Okay.
If I had to guess, maybe $400 recipe? That is too much money for pasta sauce.
The sauce I plan to make sounds really fancy, but at the end of the day, it's a fairly simple sauce.
I don't see the actual instructions, and it doesn't look like he left me any. This is gonna be a challenge for sure. Like, there's really no directions.
And everything's gonna be braised together. And it's gonna kind of take this really tough piece of meat and make it super, super soft and tender.
Could I actually get Rose on the phone now? I have some questions. Hey Rose, it's John, how are you?
Good, how are you, John? It's okay. Nice to see you.
You too, I'm freaking out a little bit. So first up for his meat sauce, Frank has short ribs, which I've never worked with before.
With short ribs, I think the best way to go is to sear them a little bit first and get some nice browning going on, and then cook them low and slow in a sauce. You're not gonna wanna cook them all the way through just by searing them. After you sear it and you really finish cooking it in the sauce, you're gonna wanna shred it because you don't want a big hunk of meat. Two forks should do the trick. Just kind of pull it apart and then mix it together. It's gonna be so good. You're gonna be great.
You wanna come here and help me make it?
I do. I'll come and help you eat it.
Oh, there you go. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it.
All right, thank you. Have fun. We'll see you soon.
Bye, Rose. Not vastly different from my recipe, just again, a few new ingredients. Olive oil in there. So let's throw in our beautiful short ribs. Look how nice these hunks of meat are. Sorry, was that sexual again? I'm sorry. I didn't mean for it to be. Well, she called it a hunk of meat too on the phone, so it's not just me. So while that's cooking, I'm gonna cut up my guanciale. Again, this is the jowl. It's fatty, as we know, just like bacon. And I know Frank likes these fancy cuts of meat. Looks like it's getting nice and brown on that one side. Again, I know Rosemary said I don't wanna fully cook it in here, so I'm just looking to get it nice and brown on all the sides, and then I'll take it out.
John gave me some simple ingredients, but the way I'm gonna tackle this is I'm gonna try to build layers of flavor in my pot. Just a little bit of oil, bacon, you stack up, and we're gonna just cut it into nice strips, and it goes right into the pot. So the bacon's gonna get brown, it's gonna render off some of its fat, and we're gonna take it out and leave the fat in there to brown off our vegetables.
I think this is ready to come out. It looks braised on all sides, nice and brown. Now that the meat's resting, and braised on all the sides, I'm gonna start the sauce. Our onions, garlic, carrots, and the guanciale.
This bacon fat is kind of liquid gold at this point. So once the bacon starts to get brown, I'm gonna take it out. Next thing we're gonna do is brown our meats, the beef and the pork. And I'm doing all this over a fairly high heat because I wanna get some browning. Browning equals flavor. And this is kind of our second layer of flavor. I'm gonna strain off some of the fat, not all the fat. You want some of the fat in there. I'm gonna add it back to the pan, not all of it. And then I'm gonna start adding my aromatic vegetables. Onions, I have a clove of garlic that I'm just gonna whack up. Carrots, and I have some celery. All of these ingredients right now are kind of fundamentals to a good ragu or a good bolognese. Originally, John had butter at this stage. I'd much rather add the butter at the end of the sauce. I think adding the butter at the end when we actually toss the pasta is gonna give us a better flavor.
So I'm guessing I take the orange as well as the basil and parsley and do a little Frank bouquet with it. Figure out how Frank does this.
I find that orange rind bumps up that tomato flavor. It has a little bit of sharpness to kind of cut some of that fat.
Hold on.
Now that the vegetables you can see on the bottom of the pot, we're getting a little brown. I'm gonna add my bacon back.
Hold on.
And I'm gonna add all of my meat back.
No. Wait, maybe.
And we give it a stir. I'm gonna add my tomato paste. When I do this sauce, I always add a little more tomato, but tomato paste is super concentrated, has a nice rich flavor. This doesn't need red wine. There's a lot of flavors going on. So I'm gonna add just a nice couple of glugs of white wine. And I truly believe that you don't need to use great wine for this. I think box wine is okay. Give me the box, I'll make it work. It'll still taste great. If I smell it, I'm gonna smell the alcohol boiling out, and that's basically what I wanna do with this.
A little for the sauce, and a little for me. Ooh, it's a nice vintage. I don't cook with red wine too much, but when I do, you gotta drink it. So my red wine's cooked down. Now I'm gonna go ahead and add my veal stock. I've never worked with veal stock before, and turns out that this is homemade from Frank. Thank you, Frank. Little handy dandy bouquet with the orange peel and the basil.
And we're just gonna add enough chicken broth to basically cover the meat. One thing home cooks don't do is you should be tasting. And I think I'm good with seasoning right now. You can see right now that it's really liquidy, and I want some of that liquid to cook out. I'm gonna lower the heat just a little and just let it simmer away happily. And what I'm looking for is that this is gonna coat our pasta.
I could just buy crushed tomatoes, but no, I get to get my hands dirty, so. Ooh. My tomatoes got a little overexcited. And I just wanna get it to a nice consistency where I don't feel any giant clumps. It smells so good. I actually smell the orange zest. This is the beautiful braised short rib. Just a nice dash of salt. Black pepper. I have these beautiful Calabrian chili flakes, but this will give the sauce a nice little kick to it. I don't know how spicy these are, so I'm only gonna add, let's say like half a teaspoon. And I'm gonna let it simmer for a few hours, covered. I'm feeling pretty good. This was challenging, but not as hard as I expected. After that, I think everyone deserves one of these. Thanks, Frank.
So what I did a little different than what a normal home cook might do, I didn't just dump everything to the pot. What I did was I built layers of flavor. Bacon fat. Those roasty flavors come through in the sauce. We want our food to have layers of flavor, and that's what we did. We built layers of flavor. Now the garlic bread. John gave me like kind of a soft kind of deli loaf. It's not a bad thing. I like something a little sturdier.
So I've never done this before, but Rose gave me a lot of great tips. Frank also has me making pizza dough for his garlic knots.
If you have access to a standing mixer, that's gonna make your life a lot easier. And you can pinch off a little bit and stretch it. It's called the window pane test. And if you can see through the dough, that means you've got really nice gluten development.
Thank
the garlic
you.
Knots are gonna be, I think they're gonna be your easiest part.
Oh, good, I was actually worried about that, so that's good to hear. Gonna use a pizza hook, which is there, and get that dough to a nice consistency where I could almost stretch it and look through it like a window, she said. We'll see. 00 flour, salt, sugar, the dry yeast, olive oil, and some water. Please let this work. Ingredients are combining, looking good so far. Turn up a little more. Okay, too much, we're gonna go back down. This is kind of silly to do all this work when I could just go downstairs to the pizzeria and get some garlic knots, but in true Frank fashion, we're gonna do it the fancy way.
First thing I'm gonna do is cut it in half. So I'm gonna use unsalted butter, and it's room temperature. Always fresh cracked black pepper. I control the salt now. I like pecorino cheese a lot better than like Parmesan, and I'll probably get some hate mail about that. I just think it has a lot more flavor than Parmesan. So I'm really happy that John chose pecorino. Some garlic, that's a lot of garlic. I don't need this much garlic. I'm gonna also put a little chopped parsley in there, a little bit of olive oil, and then bring it all together.
I mean, that looks like dough to me. I think this is good. I feel like this is good to go. That looks pretty smooth to me, I think. Yeah, let's try it.
Confidence.
So now to check if my dough is ready, I'm gonna take a note from Rose and see if it looks like a window pane. Thanks for the tip, Rose. So I'm gonna transfer this dough into a bowl with olive oil and just let it rise and really activate that yeast. I'm gonna cover up the dough with some plastic wrap and just let this rise up. So my dough is resting. Now I'm gonna make the compound butter for my garlic bread. Fancy Italian butter, raw garlic, roasted garlic, fresh parsley and basil here, salt, pepper, olive oil, and then of course, Parmigiano Reggiano. This is the good stuff. These are gonna be some really tasty garlic knots. All right. I'm just gonna give it a little taste to make sure it's all good. Mmm, there's some fancy ass butter.
Nice generous amount of the butter. Don't leave anything naked. Last, I'll take some more of that sharp pecorino and go over the top with it. I probably used a lot less garlic than John. I don't want this to kind of be offensive and overpowering. If you add mozzarella to this, it might bump it up a couple of notches.
The dough has risen quite a bit, as you can tell. Oh my God, it's so nice. Maybe I just play with this and we call it a day, you know? A garlic knot isn't that difficult of a shape. It's kind of like a pretzel, but more clumped together. I really have no idea what I'm doing. Okay. I'm just gonna try, we'll see. Like, this is what I was thinking, I don't know if it makes sense. Maybe it's like a cinnamon bun. Garlic knot? You know, I would love to bother Rosemary again, but gotta figure this out on my own. We're gonna leave this as test subject A. That one was more of a swirl action than a knot. So this one, I'm gonna roll it out and actually tie it like a true knot. And there's a garlic knot. God, I'm so smart. Ha ha. This is actually really fun. Been to so many pizzerias in my lifetime growing up here in New York, and I feel like I've seen different iterations of garlic knots, some fat, some small, some really garlicky, some not. I hope these make Frank proud. I'm gonna keep the test one there as a reminder that you can achieve better. We're just gonna finish this off with a little flaky sea salt. Now these puppies are ready for the oven. Let's try to make some pasta. And then I've seen Frank do this before. A little nest for the eggs, if you will. Maybe should have made a deeper well in there. Oh, try three, whoop. Oh no. My little lava didn't work out, but we'll fix it.
So John gave me fettuccine. It's a dry pasta product. Fresh pasta is kind of a special occasion thing. If you add the pasta to the pot when it's not boiling, it's gonna start clumping together. Most people think that it clumps together, they need to add oil to the water. Not necessary, no oil in the water. So we're waiting for the water to boil, and normally I just have a beer. Not the option here. I want beer. It's never too early. It's 5 o'clock somewhere, right? That's what they always say.
Salt, texture's really weird, really sticky. My grandma would be so proud of me, God rest her soul, if she saw me making dough for homemade pasta. Like, this is pretty cool. Still a little sticky, so I'm gonna add just a little more flour. This is work, working up a sweat. And if you are not a fan of mess, I do not recommend making this because, as you can see, pretty messy. The dough is wrapped, so I'm gonna let it rest for about an hour.
We are boiling. I'm gonna add a fair amount of salt. If you don't have high blood pressure, don't worry about it. It's gonna be fine. I'm gonna drop my pasta in. At this point, you don't wanna leave it alone, right? You wanna continue to stir so that it doesn't stick together, right? So I'm gonna just let it cook a little, and I'm gonna come back to it. Traditionally, I like to use a thicker pasta or a pasta that has some sort of shape to it so that it holds the sauce. Fettuccine is not horrible, but a wider pasta like the pappardelle that I wanted to do has more surface area for the pasta sauce to cling to. I wonder how John's doing right now.
Laminated pasta. Talk to Rosemary about it. Yeah, so what is laminated pasta? I've never heard of that term.
You're gonna make sheets of pasta with the herbs. You're not gonna mix them into the pasta dough while you're making the pasta. You're gonna lay them onto the sheet and then fold it over or cover it with another sheet of pasta. So you have this really pretty, almost stained glass effect.
Dust our dough, a little for good luck. Take a chunk of dough like that. I want it to get super thin. Okay, not that difficult yet. Roll out this other, whoop. So now to get that stained glass effect, I'm just gonna lay out some leaves of fresh parsley and basil. So now I'm gonna take my other piece of pasta, cover it, and then put it through the roller again to make it that nice laminated pasta that Frank so very much wants. That kind of does look like stained glass. I'm gonna go in and make nice thick strips of pasta. I think the nice thickness in these noodles will complement the meat. Now we're gonna finish up our beautiful laminated pasta with some flour. I think this will make for some really nice pasta to complement our ragu. Now the test will come when we cook it.
I'm just gonna cook it 3/4 of the way. I'm gonna finish cooking it in the pot. This way, the pasta finishes cooking in the sauce. It's gonna soak up some of the sauce. The starch from the pasta is actually gonna thicken the sauce a little. Tasting your pasta and testing it using your teeth is the best way to do it. Throwing it on the wall, I don't know what kind of walls you have at home, but I don't want pasta sticking on my wall. I'm gonna take my pasta out and I'm gonna add it to my sauce. I'm not too worried about having some extra water on there. It's not a big deal, because we're gonna finish cooking the pasta in the pot. I know it's probably much easier to use a colander over the sink, but this, I promise you, is gonna yield a better product at the end.
So now let's finish off our bolognese. Oh yeah, this meat is super tender. It's really just coming apart. I'm pulling it apart lightly with a fork. What I wanna do is get an even consistency of the short rib throughout the dish. You know, I imagine Frank is doing something really phenomenal with my bolognese recipe.
I'm gonna take a little bit of that butter that I talked about that I saved from the beginning, and I'm gonna add it to the sauce. And this is where John's sauce differs from mine. My sauce is a little more tomato forward. You can see that we put tomato paste in this sauce, but it's not really a tomato sauce. It's more of a meat sauce with a little bit of tomato product in it.
I'm gonna do a little taste test to make sure it's cooked all the way through.
Oh my God, oh my God.
I'm gonna add a little more of this pasta water, right? Because again, I want my pasta to finish cooking in the sauce. Once I start to see the sauce thicken a little more and stick to the pasta, I'm gonna test it with the spoon and I'll show you what I'm looking for. I dip it in, you can actually see the sauce has some weight to it and it's coating the back of the spoon. It's not as watery, you can actually see that it's fairly thick. You can see that the sauce is starting to stick to the pasta, and I think I'm done here. Now all I gotta do is plate it up.
And because it's fresh pasta, it's actually gonna cook really quickly in about 2 to 3 minutes. Olive oil, throw in some garlic. God, that's beautiful. Pour the heat a little bit. I'm just gonna transfer it right from the boiling water into our sauce. This feels like how they do it in the restaurants. I've seen it, but never actually did it myself. This is pretty cool. Don't wanna get too much water in there, but a little pasta water is actually quite tasty, so I don't mind. Pasta bolognese. So all that's left to do is to toss these knots with the compound butter and they'll be ready to eat.
Just gonna use all of it. It looks so delicious, come on.
Oh God, it smells so good. You can really smell all the flavors in the compound butter. These look awesome. This was a lot of work for garlic knots, but I think it was worth it. I mean, look how awesome these look, come on.
I'm gonna grab my bread and cut it. I'm gonna kind of make it a little fancy. Okay, I'm gonna cut it on a nice steep angle.
Oh my God, it looks so good. And I'm gonna try to be fancy like restaurant like Frank does.
I'm gonna use my tongs to twirl it up together and I'm gonna carry that over to my plate. I dripped a little. I'm gonna spoon a little of my sauce on top. I like a little more sauce than the Italians would.
I like a nice saucy pasta and I wanna make sure there's a lot of meat. So I'm gonna go in there and grab some of the good bits. Ever so lightly throw a little olive oil on there. That's good stuff.
Just a nice little shaving. You don't want to overdo it with the pecorino. It's a strong cheese, so it might overpower. So just go nice and easy. A little bit of black pepper, and then just a touch of extra virgin olive oil. Gives it a little shine. Take your bread, put it on the plate, so it stands up a little. With little bunny ears, pasta bolognese with garlic bread.
I love this stuff, and at the restaurant, I just have them keep going and going and going. I'm gonna do the same. And then the final pièce de résistance, 2 of our homemade garlic knots. And there you have it, some expensive bolognese.
And this is just a simple, comforting dish. There's nothing complicated about it. We used simple ingredients and made something beautiful with it. I really, really hope John likes my pasta.
This was a lot of work, but honestly, I can't wait to taste it because it looks like it was worth all the effort.
Hey, John, nice to meet you.
Hi,
finally
Frank.
Get to meet you.
Really excited about this.
Really excited. I can't wait to see how you did.
Yeah. I hope I made you proud.
That looks really good. So with your dish, I didn't really change much. I kind of focused on like the layers of flavor that were going on. You had some really great ingredients, mm-hmm. and all I did was focus on good technique.
These are a lot of first-time techniques for me, but I think I did you justice.
Right? Good. The flavor is great. The meat is amazing. And I love the chew of this. It takes that meaty sauce and it like stands up to it. I'm gonna have another bite.
That's what I expected. Yeah. Does it taste like yours?
It's pretty close.
Okay, I'll take pretty close.
I'm a heavy seasoner.
Sure.
We're gonna crack that open and get a view of it, but look at that. See how like your crumb is really nice in there? Some great garlic flavor. The dough is like perfect. It's not like, you could easily make this super chewy and gross, but it's light and fluffy and it's really garlicky and delicious. And considering you've never made any of this before, like, I'm blown away.
I did feel like your presence was with me throughout the way. I had, you know, your recipes. I want to see how I did because, again, first time.
Mmm. Oh my God, this blows away any pizzeria garlic knot.
Exactly. Are you gonna try mine? Now I'm a little nervous.
Mm. Oh my God.
It almost has, correct me if I'm wrong, a slight carbonara ring to it.
Because I put a little butter in towards the end too, and the butter in the end really kind of puts that dairy component in without having to put milk. Did I do okay?
Absolutely. Okay. Did you do okay?
The guanciale doesn't have that kind of smokiness. Mm-hmm. The bacon is really strong there.
Yeah.
Again, that brings me back to my childhood too, like garlic bread.
It's a staple. Awesome. This is exactly what I wanted.
I think that we killed it. We crushed it. It kind of proves to me that, like, you know, if you just jump into it, you can do it, you know, and you shouldn't be afraid of it. Like, I wish the first time I made pasta and bread was that good.
Well, I had a good teacher. Yeah. Aw, get over here.
Great to finally meet you.
You too. And your eyes really are as blue as the ocean. Like, I could get lost in them. Oh, thank you. Yeah.